Welcome to Oregon Voters Digest, the program that brings forward the social and political issues that are important to people living here in the Pacific Northwest. And now, your host, Bruce Broussard.
Welcome again to this segment of the Oregon Voters Digest. I'm Bruce Broussard, your host. Folks, as you are aware, the month of February is pretty well celebrated as Black History Month. And so this will be my show talking from the Oregon Voters Digest standpoint, what is Black History Month? I'll come up with a few little historical facts, if you will, and then we'll go into that. And then the bulk of the show is that I've got two individuals that have been here for quite some time, very much involved in community, finance, communication, journalism. I mean, you go on and on and on, and we're fortunate to have both Eugene Richard and also Mr. Winters, James Winters. And it's going to be a great deal. So stick around, invite your friends, and see what we can do. In fact, if there's a possibility, we might open up the lines. Maybe open up the lines, but the bottom line is that I'm going to take advantage of this opportunity to really give them the opportunity to express themselves. They've got a lot to say. And by the way, this is going to be a whole new twist, too, by the way, in this. You know, typically, and I've done this, too, in the past here on the Oregon Voters Digest, I've talked about Black history. Every time you talk about Black history, everybody goes back to historical facts or whatever, but no one talks to, what about today? What about today? And today, bottom line, is a job, making dollars, if you will, dollars and cents aspect of it. So consequently, we're going to talk about that. You'll get a better feel of what that is as we get into the discussions. But anyway, let's start off. If you notice, I'm donning, if you will, my Buffalo Soldier hat, if you will. Thank you very much, Dean. And you know, at one point in time, I was president of the local chapter of the Buffalo Soldiers Association, and you might have seen me in that particular capacity. Normally, I'd have the uniform and whatever, sort of out of uniform, because as a former Marine, you know, you got to be in a uniform. But I thought I'd wear the hat from a historical standpoint, so we can go back in those times that related to that particular time in history. I've got a piece here to read from a piece that you've seen this also on the show. It was called The Freedom Calendar, and it goes back in the 1800s, back during the Lincoln era, if you will. And as you know, the Lincoln film just come out. I know some of you have probably looked at this Lincoln piece, if you will, just of late, and I thought it would be very appropriate to kind of highlight that piece in another way. But then at the same time, I'm going to leave you with, if you will, i.e. Googling that, if you will, on your smartphone, or going to your computer, if you will. You can just Google up Lincoln or whatever, and it goes back in time. Or you can Google off Buffalo Soldiers. You can go back in time. But rest assured, Black Americans, Negro Americans, African Americans, we participated in slavery. We participated in this country and the building of this country from day one. And a lot of folks tend not to want to accept that. And I want to make sure that you understand that, so therefore you can get that history. Again, like I said, I'm donning the Buffalo Soldier hat, if you will, during that particular time. And I've got this page that I want you to read. And a lot of times people are defining the Buffalo Soldiers back in those days, if you will, as you know, during the 1863 era, during the Lincoln era aspect of it, during the Civil War, i.e. the North between the South aspect of it. Many slaves, African Americans, or if not at that point in time, and I'm going to throw this out to you, these were Black Americans now, because Black Americans and white Americans were fighting for this country. Otherwise, we were fighting for the Stars and Stripes, and Black Americans were part of that, okay? And on the other side of the line, there was the Confederacy aspect of it, and so they were doing their peace aspect of it. But some 350,000 Black Americans fought during the Civil War during that particular time. And there were a lot of changes during that time, too. And that's why I want to read this particular excerpt. It's going to be surprising. So I'm going to throw this out there right off the bat. I'm going to read this piece. And then, as I say, I'm donning the hat. It says, now, check this out. The Republican Party, 150 years of advancing civil rights. To stop the Democrats' pro-slavery agenda, anti-slavery activists founded the Republican Party, starting with a few dozen men and women in Ripon, Wisconsin, on March 20, 1854. The party spread across the northern and western United States like a prairie fire of freedom. The first Republican state convention was held in Jackson, Michigan, in July 1854. The Republican National Committee met for the first time in 1856, followed 4 months later by the first Republican National Convention. In the election of 1860, Republicans swept to victory in the White House and won majorities in both houses of Congress. Just 6 years after the party's founding, the governor of every northern state in America was a Republican. That phenomenal progress was possible only because the Republican Party was based on the powerful idea that our nation, conceived in liberty and dedicated to equality, must live up to its founding principles. Despite fierce Democrat opposition, Republicans passed constitutional amendments banning slavery. Have you heard that before? Extending the Bill of Rights to the state, guaranteeing equal protection of the laws and the process to all citizens, and extending the right to vote to persons of all races and backgrounds. Republicans in Congress also enacted the nation's first ever Civil Rights Act, which extended citizenship and equal rights to people of all races, all colors, and all creeds. In 1875, the Republicans expanded these protections to give all citizens the right of equal access to all public accommodation. Remember that word? Mm-hmm. Okay, struck down by the Supreme Court 8 years later, the landmark legislation would be reborn as the 1964 Civil Rights Act. Republicans led the fight for women's rights, and most suffragists were Republicans. In fact, Susan B. Anthony bragged about how, after voting illegally in 1873, she had voted a straight Republican ticket. The suffragists included two African-American women who were also co-founders of the NAACP, Ida Wells and Mary Terrell, great Republicans, both of them. Republican Senator Aaron Sargent wrote the Women's Suffrage Amendment in 1878, though it would not be passed by Congress until Republicans again won control of both houses 40 years later. It was in 1916 that the first woman was elected to the U.S. House of Representatives, Republican Jeanette Rankin. The first woman mayor was elected in 1926, the Honorable Bertha Landers of Seattle, another great Republican. Democrat opposition to Republican efforts to protect the civil rights of all Americans lasted not only throughout Reconstruction, but well into the 20th century. In the South, those Democrats, now here we go again, who most bitterly opposed equality for blacks founded the Ku Klux Klan, which operated as the party's terrorist wing. Every single African American in Congress until 1935 was a Republican. Among the Republican pioneers were South Carolina's Joseph Rainey, the first black member of the House of Representatives. In 1870, Republicans Hiram Revels of Mississippi became the first black U.S. senator the same year. 2 years later, Prinsky Pinchback of Louisiana became the nation's first black governor. First black governor of Louisiana. California was the first state to have a Hispanic governor. Republican Romualdo Picaro in 1875, the first Hispanic. That ain't going on and on, but my point is that there's a lot of history there that, in all due respect, should be taught in schools. It should be taught in schools. I shouldn't be reading this to you for a first time. That's what we should have been having in this country from day one, if you will. As if to say, that's why I said I donned this hat. A lot of folks didn't realize the number of black Americans that participated in this country back in the 1800s that made this America that we have today. And even today, and now I'm going to take this hat off and I'm going to don my other hat. And I'm sure you're familiar with the participation of African Americans and black Americans in our present situation in the Marine Corps. As I spent my 10 years in the Marine Corps, I spent my time in Vietnam, and that's how I came to Portland, Oregon. But many black Americans are still participating in defending this country, if you will. And I can go on and on and on about that part. So anyway, that's my history on this little entree part. So please go back in time. You've got the smartphones, you've got computers and whatever. Dig this history out, and then call your various congressmen and representatives and tell them how important this is to get this in our schools, get this in our education system, i.e., to basically let the people know that in fact that we're all patriots, if you will, of this particular country. It's very, very important. Okay, so that's the history part. And so now why don't we get down to today? And like I said, I've donned this particular hat, get the military out. And now my present status is that as a businessman and a community participant and whatever, I thought now is the time we can talk about Black History Month and working contributing. And I've got my two guests here, and I think we can start talking about it. And I'll just start off with, and I'll throw something on the table just briefly. I have made the call. Again, this is February. We'll be out of February in the next two shows and whatever. I've called two entities, Human Resources Department, of both Nike and Intel. The whole idea is that just recently, the governor just signed off with, i.e., lowering their taxes or giving them some tax advantages, if you will, for building, if you will, expanding their particular respective businesses, and suggesting that they were going to also benefit Oregonians. So my position is that, okay, fine. If it's going to benefit Oregonians, then who are these Oregonians? Why don't we educate, if you will, the population, i.e., Black Americans, for job opportunities that Intel? Okay, so what jobs are going to be available, and how are they going to make sure they get those into those educational facilities to educate people so that, in fact, they can gain those jobs? So I would say that, again, to the governor, that I'd like to know what those numbers are going to be. I'd like to know where you're going to teach, where you're going to have Intel. In fact, if I had anything, I'm going to have Intel and Nike on the show. For some folks from Human Resources and whatever, to basically identify specifically what are these new jobs, okay? Where are these new jobs, and how are you going to go about retaining? Hopefully, you're not going to be getting foreigners to come in to get these jobs. Maybe you're going to get together with PCC, community colleges, if you will, in the high schools, and maybe consider doing a voc ed program, a charter school program or whatever. But the whole idea is that put together a training program so some of these folks that are sitting up here in these various communities can basically be trained to get those, i.e., middle-class kinds of jobs. So anyway, that's my so-called version of the new so-called Black History Month. Let's talk about jobs, and so we can divert some of those situations where young people today, the majority of which, the only thing they can be looking forward to is getting into the criminal justice system, and therefore, i.e., providing, if you will, jobs to people who are making money. It's kind of interesting in this country, especially this country across the board. People are willing to pay something like $40,000 to $60,000 for incarceration of a person, as opposed to giving them a job at $10 or $15 an hour. Interesting. So, gentlemen, I'm throwing it on the table. Let's start talking. Welcome, Gene. Welcome, James.
Thank you.
Okay. So let's talk about Black History Month from your perspective. When
here's my perspective.
Talk to me.
Here's my perspective. Your listeners and your viewers just heard you lay out a legacy that's your lived experience. You joined the Buffalo Soldiers. You are a Marine. You certainly demonstrated your patriotism to this nation. And you are interested in the plight of people in this moment, certainly in Multnomah County throughout the state of Oregon. And you've been doing this program for how long now?
Oh, about 15 years.
So let me ask you a question.
Yes.
Where do you get your passion?
My passion, you know, I don't even have to think about it. It's just my exposure, Gene. I'm not trying to catch up.
Yeah, no problem. I just want to explore this a little bit. So we are all products
of
our exposure.
Exactly.
What does Black history look like today in the 21st century, 2013, and why should we care? Mm-hmm. I want to come at Black history from mm-hmm. that perspective, mm-hmm. if I can.
Sure.
I don't see any young people waving the banner of Black History Month. Mm-hmm. Now, just taking your life and your mm-hmm. lived experience right. is a good example. You came here as a Marine. You became a Marine recruiter. Became a general contractor. Mm-hmm. You ran for a public office, mm-hmm. a political office. You've run for political office a couple of times, and you raised the level mm-hmm. of awareness. You raised questions about how can we get to the most misfortunate mm-hmm. folks who are on the ladder of low socioeconomic status, folks that suffer from health disparities, from economic disparities. I just want to stay on you for a moment, Mr. Mm-hmm. Broussard, because through your lens of lived experience, you are very valuable to this state, to this county, to this city. You really, really are. And that you're doing Oregon Voters Digest, that's a big thing. Now, how do we make Black History Month significant? I tell you how we can't make it significant. Mm-hmm. We're not making it significant when we look at it through an economic lens only, mm-hmm. when we look at it through a political lens or an educational lens only, not even through a health lens only. We have to look at it through a relational lens. Mm-hmm. See, Black History Month is supposed to be an opportunity for people to connect and communicate. Mm-hmm. The question becomes, how do you communicate with poor blacks who are on a different frequency? How do you communicate with poor whites and brown people and yellow people and red people who are on a different frequency? Black History Month should be a month to celebrate the question that we're trying to answer for the other 11 months. How can we broaden and improve access for poor people, mm-hmm. period? So looking at this through a relational lens, the question becomes, what frequency are people on who are living on government subsistence, mm-hmm. poor housing, poor health outcomes, and how do you communicate with them? See, the problem is that poor people are looking at their lives through an entertainment lens.
Mm-hmm. Interesting.
Mm-hmm. Through an athletic lens. Did our team win? Did Beyonce break, you know, did she sell a million copies? Mm-hmm. You're gonna watch her. See, the entertainment lens is not good enough for us. Mm-hmm. We don't have the luxury of art for the sake of art. Back to you. So your show is giving us access to that question. How do we create access for poor populations to the resources of this community, mm-hmm. of this state? And we haven't really done a good job of answering that question yet. As a matter of fact, we don't really do really well with the social contract. You wanna know what disenfranchisement looks like? Disenfranchisement looks like those 20 kindergartners that got killed in Newtown, mm-hmm. and those six adults that got killed with them. Disenfranchisement is that police officer, that rebel police officer that got killed in California. Disenfranchisement looks like the arbitrary daily drive-by shootings that gang-affected youth are being impacted by and their families and communities and so on and so forth. So this community has not done a good job with disenfranchisement. You know why? They don't know what it looks like. You know why they don't know what it looks like? Because they're not talking to people on their frequency. Let's get some, okay, so Rob Ingram died, great community champion. Mm-hmm. Let's get some Montreal Granvilles here, okay? Let's get some Karanja Cruises in here. Let's get some Professor Andre Browns in here. Let's get some Corey Murphys in here. Many of you viewers may not know who these people are, but they are a wonderful connection and conduit to the young people. I think Black History Month should be about what kind of strategies can we come up with to reach young people. Take James Winters. Mm-hmm. He's an entrepreneur. Mm-hmm. He's a professor at Portland State University. Oregon State is vetting him. Mm-hmm. These are the people that we need in front, on the front lines. You know about front lines. You're a military man. What we got on the front lines now are gatekeepers, mm-hmm. people who are mm-hmm. pontificating,
yes.
people
yes.
who are not taking advantage of mm-hmm. and responsibility for these public airwaves.
Yeah.
This is a grand opportunity to raise the question and keep raising the questions. Organized religion has done a horrible job of preparing people to go out into the world. It's about cul-de-sacs. It's not about community. Mm-hmm. Until organized religion has the pulse of the people, mm-hmm. a captive audience. Until organized religion gets to that place that says, we're not preparing people to go to heaven. We're preparing people to make a heaven on earth, which means you have to honor the social contract. Mm-hmm. The heaven away up in the sky will take care of itself. Mm-hmm. But until we honor the social contract, making those connections now because we understand the frequency in which a person is on, we're going to be the same place this year during February,
yeah, exactly.
as we were last
exactly.
year, as we'll be next year. Mm-hmm. So having you here to raise this question during February, the shortest month of the year, and having the Honorable James Winters here, I think is a good start.
Yes, appreciate
I think
that.
It's a good start.
Appreciate that.
So thank you for that.
Thank you. James.
Let me make sure my voice is still, no, I'm just playing. I would agree with a lot of what Eugene said. One of the things that I probably would take exception is the economic lens. I think that needs to be the biggest lens. You've alluded to a lot of things in the document that you read from, but economically, we haven't been able to change much in 200 years. We're still 16% unemployment, higher rate of poverty. And in my opinion, that all comes from a lack of economic opportunity. And I think a lot of the focus, and it's easy when I go to Black History Month events, I think what I see is a lot of individuals that come to this event once a year and then they have really nothing to do with African Americans for the rest of the time. As a matter of fact, just by coming there, a lot of them feel like they have the right not to have anything to do with African Americans. So I think the whole purpose of Black History Month has been lost in political posturing and correctness. What I would say is that economically, not only are African Americans who are uneducated suffering, but African Americans who are educated, did everything they were supposed to do, are suffering as well. We didn't, a lot of us did not go and drive by and start shooting at people. Some of us came from poverty, some of us had good families, but we're playing by the rules. And the rules say if you do that, at the end of the day, if you want to start your own business, this is what should be available to you.
Yes.
That is not available to us.
No.
And no one has stepped up and said anything, and a little bit amount of money that is available, you couldn't buy a suit at Mario's with. So and until that discussion as takes place, you can't tell somebody who's in poverty to go to school and to stay out of trouble and don't hang out with so-and-so when all they're going to end up with is with the same job they could have had if they didn't go to college. There has to be a clear opportunity window for somebody to step through and say, you know what, I can see the cost that I got to put up with now and the benefit later. And it's very, very difficult to show with a lot of the things that Eugene said was correct about the gatekeepers, but that's by design. I don't blame the gatekeepers themselves. I blame the person that gave them the keys.
It's employment.
Yes, absolutely. So it's not that they're at fault because they're doing what they can do with the talent they have, and the talent they have is not much. So this is the best way for them to make a living and accomplish something is to try to act as a conduit between the African American community and the rest of city, state, and federal government. So I understand that. But for us to change things, we have to be able to economically step to the next level. There's no African American fund managers in the state, and the probably 25 to 35% of the pension funds that are managed by the state of Oregon come from people of color, our employees now. So we're good enough to put our money in there, but we're not good enough to invest it. The taxes are the same way. The payroll taxes, that's what primarily supports the state of Oregon. We put our share of payroll taxes in, and when these state-sponsored vehicles and other financing mechanisms come out, very little of it ever reaches us. Now, regardless of how much we put in or how much we've taken out in the past, 16% of our kids are unemployed. If the function of these tax dollars being reinvested in business should be to cure that, then it needs to be reinvested with us. And somebody needs to stand up other than me and say something about it. And I'd be quite honest in saying I feel like I'm a lonely wolf up on a hill howling at the moon and nobody really cares. But I hope that we get an opportunity to have that kind of discussion in the future.
Okay, let's talk about it. I threw out a piece there a moment ago about the Intel and the Nikes, if you will, being given, if you will, the opportunity for a major tax break. And the whole idea is that the whole idea was to benefit Oregon, if you will, okay? But nothing was said about the plan, you know. What percentage, if you will, are going to be specifically benefiting Oregonians, and then breaking that down, if necessary, with reference to the various populations, like the some of the points that you're making.
Well, they have local hiring requirements.
Like, but local hiring requirements, what does that mean?
Well, from what I read, it was like 500 to 1,500 jobs over a 10-year period, which would be substantial. I'm not going to put Nike on blast because I think the alternative for them is to relocate their headquarters to another state. And the state of Oregon cannot really afford that right now. The entire revenue stream for the state of Oregon is really payroll taxes. Mm-hmm. They collect very little in terms of income tax. So they can't afford to let all those employees go. And there's a lot of municipalities in Las Vegas, Nevada, Austin, Texas, Dallas, Texas, Atlanta, Georgia would love to have a Fortune 500 company like Nike land there in their own backyard, and they would probably write some generous checks in the process. So I think it's a little bit more complicated than meets the eye. Every day I know that Tim McCabe and everybody from Business Oregon is not only trying to get business in the door, but they're trying to keep the business mm-hmm. here mm-hmm. that is already providing jobs. And it's very, very challenging for them to do so when places like Texas, who's actually running a commercial in California, saying, come here, we have lower taxes, less regulation, less cost of lands. We have headquarters, the headquarters of all headquarters mm-hmm. we can put you in, international airport. So
every state's buying anyway. Every state's
got. Yeah, but only a few can really. I could tell you that Dallas-Fort Worth, because of their airport structure and their mm-hmm. tax structure, they can compete. Atlanta, Georgia, they can compete. Once you move up into the Northeast, and you start to see the cost that we have here. You move into Chicago, you start to see some of the costs mm-hmm. and none of the benefits. But you're looking at some areas that have low climate, relatively high unemployment, and low cost of wages and low taxes. A lot of businesses are going to say, hey, you know, I need to listen to what they're saying before I commit to anything in the state of Oregon.
Mm-hmm. But let's get back, again, going back to your point about, you made mention something about the 400 to 500 jobs, if you will, that they'll provide. And I'm looking at Intel, too, because they're pretty large outfits aspect of it. They're going to be falling in that same ram to a certain degree. So when I say 400 or 500 jobs, what comes to my mind immediately is that We've already done, it's sort of like an institution now, a census tract. We've broken down basically all ethnic groups, the male, female, the whole nine yard and whatever. So if that's 400 or 500, then why don't we go to this from a fairness standpoint? Because a lot of times we went through this whole affirmative action thing and this, that, and the other. People resented that. But okay, let's go to the census tract aspect. What percentage of them are Black Americans? I mean, just go right down the list aspect and break those jobs. Come on, talk to me.
We're talking about how corporate personhood behaves in the built environment. We're putting all of our stock and trade in a couple of corporate organizations or entities with the hope that there'll be a percentage of jobs reserved or set aside for people of low socioeconomic status or people who are
right.
struggling.
Okay.
Here's the problem. Here's the problem. We've been doing that for decades. We've always looked at the portrait of corporate America rather than the landscape. Mm. See, in order to change generational poverty, you have to look at the landscape. In other words, you have to look at what does the built environment, the landscape, offer to people of low socioeconomic status in terms of opportunities. And if only two corporate entities is offering 500 jobs, how many people will that really impact in those poverty pockets that continue to be rolled over from generation to generation? See, until the least of us, you know, there are middle class folk who will do fine and probably will vie for those jobs.
Yeah.
My interest is in those who have, Ron Herndon said this one time, you know what, Eugene, we don't have enough of nothing.
Hmm.
We don't have enough of nothing. So poor people are the spotted white owl in this community.
Hmm.
Until poor people do better, society is still going to have high levels of crime, high levels of health disparity, high levels of unemployment, high levels of truancy. The criminal justice system will be overflowed, and the prison system will be the second highest a place that holds African Americans, which is in Salem.
Why don't we recognize that?
It's not that it's not recognized. It's recognized. We have analyzed this system to death. But we're not coming up, we're good at analysis, but we're not coming up with solutions to the problems. And it gets back to what I'm saying. If corporate America really wants to do something in their HR department mm-hmm. that will impact poor people, communicate with poor people on the frequency that they're on. That might mean trade schools. Mm-hmm. We need more trade schools. Mm-hmm. Everybody's not set up for a four-year college degree.
Right, exactly.
Everybody's not even set up for a two-year PCC mm-hmm. associate degree. Mm-hmm. But everybody is set up for the idea, I need a job.
Mm-hmm.
If I had a livable wage job, maybe I wouldn't gangbang. Maybe I wouldn't be selling drugs. Maybe mm-hmm. I wouldn't be out here trying to prostitute. Maybe I wouldn't be involved in the sex trade. But they are. We are impacted by that. And until we change that, we're going to still be impacted. And the gap and the gulf is going to get wider and wider. 2014 is just around the corner. This conversation will evaporate, and the same persistent problems will still be in front of us.
Good point. We'll take a short break. We'll be right back.
You are watching Oregon Voters Digest. This program can be seen again on these channels on these dates and times. Tell a friend.
Welcome again to this segment of the Oregon Voters Digest. Bruce Prichard. We're basically highlighting Black History Month, month of February, and this is basically Oregon Voters Digest take on it. I've got two outstanding guests with me, Jim Richard and James Winters, Mr. Winters, and we're talking about Black History Month, and what do we see from our exposure, if you will, respectively. And we're all different exposure aspect of it. So anyway, we were just getting into another aspect of it, and it's my understanding James would like to comment on some of the points that Eugene said.
Well, a couple of things, and this actually ties back to what you had brought up. If we're going to take issue with the subsidies that the corporate Oregonians are getting, I think we need to look at the renewable industry before we look at established businesses like Nike, because those jobs, that subsidy and that investment was given with the promise of jobs in this community, that along the same rationale that you discussed earlier. Right. Now, I don't know if this is happening or not.
Right.
And I'm pro.
And that's the question.
Yeah, I'm definitely pro renewables, but it has to be done in a way where the taxpayers are protected and this business has proven itself to be viable in the future. I have not seen a business that they've invested in. There have been very few, to me, in my opinion, have a long-term future. Most right. of them are going to be challenged. People would like to have a solar-powered house. Hmm. I mean, some of us would like to have power in our house, period, amen.
Come on.
But a solar, the problem is that these panels are coming from China that are substantially lower priced, and those are the ones that people can afford to pay for. So if you use the panels from these manufacturers here, people are like, hey, I don't want to buy them. They cost too much. So that's where we should be raising our hands and saying, wait a minute, before there's any more sustainability investment, you need to invest in sustaining this community. Before you start betting on clean water, which our water, I actually bottled it up and sold it to a couple people. I think we got the cleanest water on the planet. Before you sustain that, you need to sustain this community. And then second of all, and I've heard you talk about the whole issue with the trade school. I understand four-year college. I was blessed to go to four-year college and graduate. It's not for everybody. But there's too many of us who don't get to go. That's just the bottom line. Mm-hmm. There's too many of us. Mm-hmm. If we have the same percentage per capita that ended up in university system and graduated, I'd be happy. I close my mouth. But that doesn't happen. It's a very, very small percentage of us that actually go on to Oregon colleges or colleges elsewhere and make it. And I would tell you that with the rise of manufacturing, I believe manufacturing in this country will rise significantly in the next 10 to 15 years. Those jobs are not going to be trade school jobs. Those are going to be four-year college jobs. Engineering technicians, the days of the smokestacks and the welders.
We need blue collar to relate,
yeah, but
will,
those
to
jobs,
the bulk of to the bulk jobs, of this society.
Those jobs are not going to be.
I mean,
no, they're coming back here, but they're coming back with robots.
Robots.
They had Harley Davidson's factory on TV. Robots.
Well, maybe we ought to robots. Consider putting those robots on the shelf so a person can eat. You can't eat robots.
Well, but that's a problem now, because African Americans, we cannot redesign capitalism to suit our social desires. What we can do is change and adapt and accumulate our own wealth, our own resources.
But that's
resources.
Only a few jobs. That's just a few jobs.
Yeah. So you
can part about the social side of it and aspect of it. Guess what? More crime, more this, no jobs. But we're willing to spend $60,000 a year for a person to be in the criminal justice system, as opposed to giving the person $30,000 a year to feed his family.
So you think we should put him in a trade school for a craft or a skill that has no use, and he has no job when he comes out?
Well, I'm just saying, let's say, for instance, you got a robot that might be able to put twitches together that maybe four people would
normally
do.
That works 14 hours a day.
Okay, for four people. But in all due respect, maybe we may want to look at this piece of it. Let the four people put the twitches together as opposed to this robot, because what about the benefits, the beneficiary?
Because that is not a business benefit. Yeah. That is the best social benefit that we can make. And I'm sure I'm the minority at the table. The best social benefit that we can make is to step into the game and accumulate our own resources.
Gene, jump in this deal now. Come on, talk.
I'm finna jump on James
Winters. I'm
finna jump on his brother with all fours.
Okay,
look here. Here's the deal. There's a quiet revolution going on here in the United States of America, and the catalyst of that quiet revolution are poor people. Okay, so people in the ivory tower is talking about the robots and, you know, the redistribution of wealth and all the technological revolution and the educational requirements in order to get these limited jobs. It's all BS. And the reason why I say it's all BS, because until we look at from a pyramid, at the bottom or base of the pyramid are poor people. Mm-hmm. Is that the kind of America that you want to live in? That's the kind of America we got right now. Until we start to invert that pyramid so that everybody gets a little bit of something, it's going to be the same stuff that we've had since post-Reconstruction. Here's what I'm for. I'm not for socialism,
no,
but I'm for acknowledging how we got here. How did poor people get to this moment of disparity? It wasn't by accident. It wasn't of their own machinations wholly. But yes, to your point, Professor Winters, African Americans that are poor need to take some level of responsibility too. That is a fact. But the systems that we all operate in, the systems that create disparities, is the problem. And until we infuse those systems with equity checks,
okay,
so that, I mean, you used to call it affirmative action. We used to call it set-asides. Firm up the action, front-load it now, or pay the price later. We are living in tomorrow's dream right now, and today will be the history of tomorrow. And nothing's changed. There hasn't been a major shift in terms of poverty and distribution of wealth. Here's what I'm for. I'm for the poor person. I'm for the poor man. And I'm for the poor woman, because until we figure out a system, educationally or otherwise, that will lift up the poorest people in this society, we're going to still be to that question of how can we create a more fair society based on the Constitution, based on what's morally right, and based on the communicating on the frequency where poor people reside. They're communicating on a entertainment frequency. They follow the plights and the victories of Beyonce
and
all these rappers.
Right. But when they go home.
And when they go home to a bowl of grits day-old biscuit.
That's right. All
I'm saying is that if you give a man a plow and some seeds, he'll plow.
Mm-hmm.
Remember, Professor Winters, African Americans, Native Americans, white Americans who were indentured servants during the times that he read, we didn't ask for any of this.
Okay.
The accident of birth is important. Wait a minute. The accident of birth is important, but we didn't ask for the race. I don't define myself through my pigmentation. Right, I define myself through the opportunity and what I can give back. Too many people are thinking about what they can get rather than what they can give. That's the other problem. So until we get rid of the lens of narcissism.
Mm-hmm.
Remember, the highest value in Western society is man to object, the individual ruggedness. I got mine. And that's what the rappers say.
Yeah.
I got mine. Get yours.
Correct.
That's going to keep us to this at this level of disparity.
And that's the mindset.
And what you got, Professor Winters?
I would agree and disagree. First of all, I'm not blaming everybody poor, and I consider myself on some levels a person that's poor.
Poppycock.
I'm not blaming it on self-responsibility. I'm blaming it on a lack of vision that they can actually accomplish something, and there's a means to an end. Now, you talked about the plow and planting the seeds. Now, if you're going to do all that work and you plant the seeds and only all you get is a little stalk this high, why are you going to be bothering planting the seeds?
You can get a bumper crop.
Well, you need to get a bumper crop. And right now, we're planting our seeds, and that's getting educated, getting together.
Educated where? Portland Public Schools? Where's voc ed?
All right, I went to Portland Public Schools.
I mean, people are failing. I mean, by the way, people are failing.
But is that
it's the highest failure
within
the state of Oregon?
It is.
So what do we do to those people? Criminal justice system?
No, we don't.
So what do we do?
No, you have. Here's the problem. You talked about these tax breaks earlier. These tax breaks. These tax breaks for property tax abatement, property tax is what pays for these schools.
Yeah.
And when you give these companies a tax break, there's less money for the schools, and the state has to kick in more. The state doesn't have any more money, so schools start closing down. More wealthy districts with higher property values, people start moving out to there, and pretty soon the inner city schools have nothing they can support.
Take care of their own. That's exactly what he said. They're going to take care of their own. They'll put that money in.
So what is that? That was what I just explained to you. That has really nothing to do with people that live around the school. Is a public policy decision that has been made by the local government to give tax abatements to corporations, to give tax abatement here and there, and shrink the pool of amount of property taxes available for K-12. That is the problem. There's the issue.
And who are the decision makers in the legislature who are making those decisions and policies?
Well, I mean, if you, it looks like looking at that picture, you know more of them than I do.
Back at you, Bruce.
There's the problem.
I must admit, I'm just focusing. You know what I mean?
I caution everybody that everybody's entitled to their opinion. It's a free country, but I will tell you, in the future, based on where I see us, this country going economically, and with the massive amount of manufacturing coming back here, they will not need a lot of crafters. They will need engineers. They will need technicians. They will need people who went to college for 4 years. There will be untold opportunities.
Bruce, let me tell you what else they're going to need. Okay, listen.
Or at least 2 years.
Jane, Professor Winters, here's what else they're going to need. They're going to need bigger prison systems.
That's right.
They're going to need more volume in their criminal justice systems for youth. Well, hold on, for youth. They're going to need more set aside properties for enterprise zones. They're going to need more numbers because poor people are moving more and more out to the numbers. They're going to need more churches, but the churches now, people are migrating away from their home churches now because they can't afford the price of gas or public transportation. We live in a society that is based on fear. And then you go to your house of worship to try to get some relief, and now they scan the hell out of you there. So what I'm saying to you is that organized religion, back to my point, needs to teach people how to be better citizens, how to mingle with people who may not agree with you, like me and Professor Winters don't agree with everything, but we agree at the end of the day. People that can provide you access through relationship building. There's not enough relationship building. Relationship building is currency. Because when you can build relationships, you can learn about opportunities that are out there. Remember, poor people don't have access like Professor Winters. Professor Winters is being vetted.
That's the same access I do.
Hold on. Professor Winters is being vetted by Oregon State University to come down and teach a business class now.
Right.
He is currently teaching at PSU. So his lens is going to be different from the lens of poor people on Northeast Rotten.
I don't think so.
Or North Vancouver.
I don't think so.
You may not think so, but let's take
I'm
the
just
camera.
An educated
let's
hustler.
Take the camera. You definitely are a hustler.
Educated
but let's take the camera and let's go where
hustler.
The people are. Let's let's make music for the people.
Yeah. Yeah.
Let's engage and create dialogue
across the board
for
too,
the
by
people
way.
Across the board.
That's
look,
right.
We need to be lockstep with what's going to make everybody have broader access to the resources of this system. Until we get to that and buy into that, We're going to have people like Professor Winters talking about more economic disparities because in order to get this position of engineering, you got to have this credential. You got to have this star. You got to hold your head this way and poop this way. See, that's nonsense. That's the system we live in. It's a fair system, but it creates inequities.
You know, I must add that, in fact, last week's show, I had Steve Buell on. And we talked about that education piece aspect of it.
What did he say?
Well, one of the points we brought up was the fact that when this change took place about the college movement piece, we got out of Bouquet from the standpoint that Vera Katz, who was mayor at the time, and Norma Paulus, who was Secretary of State, they were the leading force, if you will, that made this transition.
Okay. Where year was that?
Said,
that was in her administration.
That was in her administration in the 80s. And at that point in time, the whole piece was, we're going to transition. And then all of a sudden, the whole voc ed stuff out of the Portland Public School arena just basically was just torn apart.
And what'd you say about that, Professor?
And then outside of the Portland metropolitan area, they did have voc ed because they had money.
What'd you say about that, Professor?
Well, I'll quote the president. It's like,
and by the way,
I spoke
to your father about that.
Horses and bayonets.
Your dad
don't have horses and bayonets.
By the way,
we have ships.
Mr. Winters was very upset about that whole plan.
He was.
We talked
but
about
this
that
was
quite
in the 1980s.
You were in college at that point.
Yeah, but in the 1980s, it was a whole different ballgame.
What different ballgame?
Because the technology has moved along so fast that these types of trades and these types of automation that we have, manufacturing things, they're making a lot of jobs, a lot of things completely obsolete. And it's not just for tradesmen. Look at where Dell Computer is. They're on their deathbed now. 5 years ago, they came out with the iPad. Now the CEO says, hey, I didn't think it would impact us. It has impacted. They sell more tablets now than they do desktop computers.
Let me look here.
Technology has moved ahead, and we have to move ahead with it.
Right now, today, the trades in the state in this country are hurting, if you will, for trained folks.
Mm-hmm.
They've gotten away from apprenticeship in the school. That's what the trades are all about.
That's the problem.
There's no jobs.
There are jobs. These people are
a welder?
Welder,
machine
iron workers.
Machines do that.
Carpenters. I mean, the whole machines.
Houses are prefabbed.
Now, wait a minute.
I mean, everything that you're talking about has now been subject to automation.
Yeah.
And I'm not saying that there's no jobs available. I'm saying to say that that's going to have any material effect on the community. And going forward, that's the best way to go. I disagree.
Right.
We need to be, this is the game. We have beaten the game every time. They had a game to bring us over here on a ship called Amistad. We beat it. They had a game over here to make
Jesus.
Us. Well, a different story, but they had a game over here to make us work for free. We beat it. They had a game over here where we couldn't drink out the same drinking fountain. We beat it. Now, this little game today, we can't beat this game.
Let me tell you something about this game.
I disagree. We can beat this game.
Let me tell you about this game. This game is really grinding up against the curve. You know what this game is? It's called soft industry. You just made your point about Dell. They flourish and then they peter out. Meanwhile, populations are not able to get in. So by the time this industry peaks and then peters out, you still got the same high levels, high rates of unemployment. So that's not the answer. Corporate America doesn't have that answer.
Mm-hmm.
So the question still is on the table, how do you create a system that provides access for everybody?
Mm-hmm.
That's the America that I want to live in. The America that you're talking about creates disparities, inequities, and crime.
I'm not going to defend all of America's system of hierarchy. I'm only addressing the way we have to play the game. And the way we have to play the game is not to say we all need to become welders or pipesmen or construction workers. That's not going to benefit us. And I would stand strongly disagree with anybody.
So engineers, right?
Engineers.
An engineer will replace how many jobs?
It's not how many jobs it will replace. It's how many jobs it would create in the future. Technology is moving at warp speed. There's so many things out there that can be a challenge and improved upon critically thinking. That is where the jobs are going to be. It will not be in as a pipe fitter.
James, let's think about this. Let's break this thing down. Check this out. You got a robot. Why do we put together a robot? Because, hey, the exactness, the perfectionist aspect
of
it.
Redundancy.
Well, 18 hours a day.
Right, but before that, i.e., there was 10 people over here.
Come on, brother.
People would make mistakes and this, that, and the other, and then they'd have to go back and clear it up and this, that, and the other. But they were working. They got a paycheck at the end of the day.
Yeah, but
10 people. Not a day. You got a robot, and you got one person.
Wait a minute.
You got one person operating the robot, because you still got to push the button to turn it on, right?
Yeah.
And then the other 9 people are out of work. Yeah. How do we feed the family?
You know what? If you want to make your contribution to society and put nine people to make a pipe and have a quality B issue and then be the type B 20 times the cost of the robot pipe.
I did not say that.
You know what? We have a system. This country was built on capitalism. We have to understand that and win with that.
I hear it. I'm just throwing it out on the table from the standpoint when we were feeding folks. And folks were somewhat equal. A man making $8 an hour, or whatever, felt good, but he was able to buy groceries, pay his rent, basically clothe his kid to go to school and whatever. Now today, he can't do that.
Right, because times have changed. So now we got new babies, jobs require education.
But now babies are having babies. They've missed the boat too. Now we got this criminal justice system out there. So the big money is making money off the criminal because they're building the buildings. And the little people are still there. Eventually, one of these days, those people are going to be getting out. So then, where do we go?
Recidivism.
Well, that's one thing I'm in favor of. I'm in favor of some type of, because it's a societal benefit economically and socially to having some kind of training program when people leave the system. I understand that. But what I don't want is an en masse, grandeur program that's going to have African Americans going to vocational school when we don't have nearly enough 4-year education students at Portland State. We don't have, if you took the athletes out of Oregon State, they only have 20% attrition rate. Right, so right. 2 out of every 10 actually graduate, and that's with the football team.
Okay.
If you took them out, it's even less than that. So we need more students out of these schools, and whatever it takes, money or whatever, giving back. We need to get our kids. We shouldn't give up.
Here's another good example real quick about the engineering part of the computers. Okay, remember at one point in time, a programmer, boy, you could make some money.
Yes, you could.
But guess what now?
What?
They've already programmed everything. You don't need no more program. They got a computer that can program everything. Everything's our program. So we don't need programs. So we got to switch. So what are you going to switch now?
Well, it comes down to creativity now.
Creativity?
Now that you got C++ code and everybody can write their own code, now what can you create with it that other people like?
Let's put a face on corporate America. While they're creating all this innovative strategy and all of these new venues of investors of technological advancement, they're also creating grief.
Mm-hmm.
They're creating grief in among communities of low socioeconomic status. See, it's not going to go away.
And this
can,
are all
you
folks,
can innovate
brother.
Yourself up to
folks.
The star.
There's no grief like no job. There's a lot of grief when you don't have a
you
job.
You can be in the ivory tower. You can come up with a new way to cough, and you can shift the weather systems. But you can't shift poverty with a cough.
You can't shift people who don't have enough of nothing with a cough.
No.
So all your innovation, all your focus on objects, you just keep on doing that. You know, there's something called reciprocity.
Mm-hmm.
There's something called for every act, there's an equal and just reaction. So that which you wish on somebody else is going to come back on you.
Mm-hmm.
So you're creating all these venues of job and technological advancement without thinking about the least of us.
Mm-hmm.
Brother, that's the stubborn.
I agree with
that's
that.
The stubborn
mm-hmm.
element
now, I haven't
of
said
society.
That.
What?
I haven't said that. I'm saying create them, but you also have to open up opportunities.
How does that
everybody.
Look? Okay, let's ask Professor Winters, how does that look on the ground?
And before that, we got about 5 minutes, but now it looks like all of a sudden we're going from Black History Month to American History Month.
I was just about to answer that question.
Are you understand where I'm coming from?
Well, yeah.
It's all of us. When you start about poor people, they have all colors across the board. So now we're getting into American History
Black
Month.
Black History Month creates disparity among white folk.
That's right.
Hold on.
I got to answer your question. Your question was, how do we do that? Now, look what the city of Portland did. We created an Office of Equity and Fairness. Is that what it is?
Who
is
this?
This is the city of Portland.
The new guy
that
came
they hired
in last year.
A very sharp, educated brother, which by
for 2 years.
Yeah, okay.
To do
but
what?
Instead of what they did. They did this. Instead of saying every manager in here is accountable for that.
Here he comes.
Instead of doing
here he comes.
Every manager part of your salary review,
that's
part
right.
of your performance review is this. Instead of doing that, they have somebody in a job just to say, well, he's doing it and he's not doing it. Instead of saying this guy, if this guy and this girl don't do it, you're out the door. Okay. They say that we've got somebody in here to monitor if everybody's doing it. They're not doing it.
Professor Winters,
interesting.
That's the template. That's the overlay that we need. Make everybody responsible for everything. Don't just put a little few folks out here in queue and say you're responsible for all those people. It's too much work. Make everybody responsible for what it means to occupy space in America. That's when it's going to work.
Yeah, they have affirmative action office. They have several people, African-Americans, in the personnel. And now we have another one, another
good point,
office
Jimmy.
For what?
Good
for
point.
What?
Well, now that was Commissioner. What was her name?
It was Amanda Fritz.
Amanda Fritz.
I'm not sure, but I mean, that's window dressing. I mean, so what?
Well, I won't go into to the exception as well. We got about another 2 minutes. But anyway, but right before I do that, geez, it's my understanding your sister's in the audience.
That Nia Shamsuddin.
Yeah, from okay, look at this, boy. I tell you what, boy, that is fantastic.
Hey, no joke.
That look like me, dude.
It is you. I'm trying to get you out there.
That's neat. That is beautiful. I want you to know, folks, we're just getting off. We got about another minute or so, and the bottom line is these guys are
thank
very,
you, Nia.
They're really into golfing and whatever, so I thought it would be a nice moment to recognize that.
We
got to
get you out
people.
There.
We'll get me out there.
Professor Winters is about a 5 handicap.
Is that? I'm a 20.
I'm 18, so you can be.
Okay, good. Well, folks, as you can see, this was my Black History Month here at the Oregon Voters Digest, and as you can see, these guys are very representative of the progression. I mean, we got to start thinking about where we are today. It's a very serious thing. History is fine. I've given you the history. That's already there. Get your smartphone out or get your computer out. You can talk about the history. It needs to be taught in the schools, okay? But what we're talking about today is earning a living across the board. It just makes good sense to get a person working so they can pay the taxes, so they can pay their rent. Because if they don't pay their rent, you have to pay the rent. And trust me, you will stress out big time. You'll use race. You'll do all these other different things, but it still comes down to the next day.
Come on.
Are you going to be paying your rent? And if you don't have your rent, you're going to be getting out. And if you don't want to get out, you're going to steal from the guy named
Come on
Doe.
And teach it.
Bottom line, okay? So let's ask those folks who are representing us today, what are you doing to deal with the issues that we were discussing here on this particular show on the Oregon Voter Digest? Folks, you've had it. Think about it. Have a good one.
Sure,
I'll see you next week.
You sure you're a
Thanks,
Republican,
guys.
Man?
What's that?
You sure you're a Republican?
A Republican?
Yeah.
In all due respect, I'm just a black man.